وأقول في القرآن ما جاءت به آياته فهو الكريم المنزال وأقول قال الله جل جلاله والمصطفى الهادي ولا أتأول
الحمد لله رب العالمين له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين أما بعد. My beloved brothers and sisters, inshallah ta'ala, today I'm going to be starting a series in which I will be speaking about practical steps in how to attain sweetness of ibadah. How could someone enjoy ibadah? Ladha, the sweetness that's in ibadah, how can I attain it and how can I achieve it? Before I go into this topic, inshallah ta'ala, I want to give you all the breakdown of how this series is going to be, inshallah ta'ala. First of all, I'm going to start bi-idhnillahi al-kareem with a muqaddimah, an introduction. And in the introduction, bi-idhnillahi al-kareem, I'm going to speak about three things, inshallah ta'ala. And after I do the introduction, and we speak about these three fundamental things that I want each and every one of you to understand, I'm going to swiftly move on to the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, Nabiullah Muhammad, the Prophet of Allah, Muhammad ibn Abdullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, how his ibadah was like. And we're going to study that inshallah ta'ala, which is the second, bi-idhnillahi al-kareem, point. Then the third, inshallah ta'ala, is going to be Salaf al-Salih, the pious predecessors. How was their ibadah like? And as I speak about the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam's ibadah, and I speak about the ibadah of the pious predecessors, inshallah ta'ala, I will be extracting benefits from there of how we can apply that in our day-to-day life, inshallah ta'ala. Especially at this particular moment that we are at home, we are isolated, and we have, walillah alhamdu wal minna, every hardship and every distress, there's always a good that can be seen in it. So what we can do, inshallah ta'ala, is this hardship, we can take from it some benefits, which is to, inshallah ta'ala, attain the sweetness of ibadah. So let me, inshallah ta'ala, start the introduction. The first point that I want to speak about in the introduction is, ibadah is something we all want from Allah to accept it from us. We all want the ibadah that we do, we want Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept it from us. And there are conditions, prerequisites that are required from each and every one of us in order for the ibadah to be accepted. So that's the first thing. What are the conditions? What are the conditions for any ibadah that we do for Allah to accept it? It's subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He told us in the Qur'an, He said to us, subhanahu wa ta'ala, الَّذِي خَلَقَ الْمَوْتَ وَالْحَيَاةَ لِيَبْلُوَكُمْ أَيُّكُمْ أَحْسَنُ عَمَلًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in this verse that He subhanahu wa ta'ala, He created us. الَّذِي خَلَقَ الْمَوْتَ وَالْحَيَاةَ. Allah tells us that He created death, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He created life. So He told us He created these two. These two, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala is saying, I created them. Allah is the one who created them. The scholars and the a'imma of tafsir, they said, the word al-maut means this life, the dunya. And the hayat is the akhirah. Allah created them both. Both of those places, darul dunya and darul akhirah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created them both for what reason? لِيَبْلُوَكُمْ, so He can test you. We're all being tested in the hardships that come, the trials and tribulations that come, the distress that come. It's all an ikhtibar, it's imtihan. This dar, this world is darum imtihan wa ibtila. It's a place of tests. If one test finishes, then another one's going to start, and then another one is going to start. But the ayah tells us how a person can overcome that test. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, لِيَبَلُوَكُمْ أَيُّكُمْ أَحْسَنُ عَمَلًا. And this test, the way to overcome it is by coming with the best of actions. The ayah says, لِيَبَلُوَكُمْ أَيُّكُمْ أَحْسَنُ عَمَلًا, the best of actions. And it doesn't say the one who has most actions or the one who has large number of actions. It doesn't say that. It says the one who has the best of actions. The question here is, what is the best of actions? I mean, what is the best actions? Fudayl ibn Iyad, who's a great imam, min a'immati salaf, he commented on this verse. And when he commented on this verse, Ibn Jarir Tabari brings it in his tafsir, Ibn Kathir also brings it, and I also believe Al-Imam Al-Baghawi brings it as well, that Fudayl ibn Iyad, he said, أَخْلَصُهُ وَأَصْوَبُهُ. أَحْسَنُ عَمَلًا means أَخْلَصُهُ وَأَصْوَبُهُ, that it's done with sincerity, and it is also done in accordance to the way that the Prophet ﷺ did it. The best of actions, the best ibadah, the accepted ibadah, is the one that meets those two conditions. أَخْلَصُهُ, it's based on sincerity. وَأَصْوَبُهُ means it's in accordance to the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he also tells us in another verse, he says, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala tells us in this verse, I did not create. So what I want inshaAllah ta'ala is, as we read the verses and as we come across the hadith, that we ponder and contemplate on it. Allah says, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ, I did not create the jinn. وَالْإِنسَ, and I did not create mankind. So they're two creations of Allah. Both of them, Allah is saying, I did not create them. The wama, the ma here is a negation. Allah said, I did not create them. And then an affirmation comes. A negation, and then right after it, an affirmation comes. Allah says, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ, I did not create the jinn. And I did not create mankind. إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ, I only created them to worship me. And then the negation, after that coming an affirmation, Allah is trying to bring what is known as al-hasr, exclusivity. Meaning, I did not create the children of Adam, and I did not create the jinn except to worship me. And then the purpose of why we are in this universe is to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ibadah is why we're here. Every single thing is a secondary thing. It should serve that purpose. The primary reason in why we're in this world today is so that we can worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Abdullah ibn Abbas came to this ayah, and then he said, إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ means أي إِلَّا لِيُوَحِدُونَ, that you single Allah in worship subhanahu wa ta'ala. So it's not that you just worship Allah. The worshipping that you're doing, the ibadah that you're doing for Allah, has to be only for Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. Which brings us to the first condition, right? أَخْلَصُهُ, Fudayl said, which is that it's done based on sincerity. You're only doing it for Allah. You're not worshipping anyone other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The first condition, the first pillar, is that you do it for Allah alone subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you do not worship Allah alone, my beloved brothers and sisters, your act is not accepted. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said in a hadith, Al-Imam Muslim narrated in his Sahih, min hadith Abi Hurairah, أنا أغنى الشركاء عن الشرك. Allah, this is a hadith Qudsi. Allah is saying, I am rich. أنا أغنى الشركاء عن الشرك. من أشرك معي غيري تركته وشركه. Anyone who associates partners with me in the act that they are doing, they do it for me and someone else, I will leave him and the thing that he associated me with. Allah will abandon you, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala will leave you with what you worshipped him besides him with, and you, he will abandon you both. Be rejected, it will mean nothing. All those years of running around and crying and worshipping, it becomes, وَقَدِمْنَا إِلَى مَا عَمِلُوا مِنْ عَمَلٍ فَجَعَلْنَاهُ هَبَاءً مَنْثُورًا. It becomes nothing, null and void, like it never happened. because he didn't meet the first criteria, which is ikhlas. Ikhlasuna lillahi saffi alqalba min iradatin siwahu fahdhar ya fatin. It wasn't done for Allah alone. وَمَا أُمِرُوا إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُوا اللَّهَ مُخْلِصِينَ لَهُ الدِّينَ حُنَفَاءَ وَيُقِيمُوا الصَّلَاةَ وَيُؤْتُوا الزَّكَاةَ وَذَلِكَ دِينُ الْقَيِّمَةِ. They were commanded, Allah says in this verse, وَمَا أُمِرُوا إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُوا اللَّهَ مُخْلِصِينَ لَهُ الدِّينَ. They were not commanded except to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with what? Ikhlas. Sincerity. Only for Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. They do not associate anyone partners with Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. They only worship Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's why the poet said, ikhlas means ikhlasuna lillahi saffil qalba min iradatin siwahu fahdhar ya fatin. It means that you cleanse from your heart, you purify from your heart anyone other than Allah. Only Allah is in your heart when you're doing this action. You're not doing it for anyone else, only Allah. Why am I stressing on this point for? What is the reason why I'm stressing on this point? Because there are people who do a lot of acts. They do a lot of ibadat. Tons of ibadat. So much. They spend days and night worshipping. But they are doing it for other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah says in the Qur'an, قُلْ هَلْ نُنَبِّئُكُمْ بِالْأَخْسَرِينَ أَعْمَالًا الَّذِينَ ضَلَّ سَعْيُهُمْ فِي الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا وَهُمْ يَحْسَبُونَ أَنَّهُمْ يُحْسِنُونَ سُنْعًا. Should we tell you a people who are in a state of loss? They are in a state of loss. Who are they? They are the ones Allah is saying, they spend their whole entire life doing something. And it was just null and void. Literally, it meant nothing. Because they didn't do it for Allah alone, subhanahu wa ta'ala. They were associating other things with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us this concept of tawheed, this concept of ikhlas, is why He sent all prophets. Allah says in the Quran, وَلَقَدْ بَعَثْنَا فِي كُلِّ أُمَّةٍ رَسُولًا أَنْ اعْبُدُوا اللَّهَ وَاجْتَنِبُوا الطَّاغُوتِ. Allah says subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَلَقَدْ بَعَثْنَا, we have sent, Allah is saying, وَلَقَدْ بَعَثْنَا فِي كُلِّ أُمَّةٍ, every single nation, every people, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He said, we sent فِي كُلِّ أُمَّةٍ رَسُولًا, a messenger. Every nation, a prophet came to them and a messenger came to them. What was his message? أَنِعْبُدُ اللَّهَ. Again, underline the word. أَنِعْبُدُ اللَّهَ, worship Allah. But in what way? وَاجْتَنِبُ الطَّاغُوتِ, and stay away from. What's a طاغوت? كُلُّ مَا عُبِدَ مِن دُونِ اللَّهِ وَهُوَ رَاضٍ. A طاغوت is everyone that's worshipped besides Allah and he's pleased with being worshipped. A طاغوت is everyone who is worshipped and is pleased with being worshipped. The reason why we said he's pleased with being worshipped is because Isa is worshipped and he's not pleased with it. Isa is not pleased with it. So the ayah says to us that every prophet that came to his people, the thing that he told his people was what? Worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and don't associate partners with Allah in anything. This is a message that from Nuh alayhi salam until Nabiullah Muhammad, it's a message that they all had. It was the conclusion of the message of all prophets. It was the zubda, this conclusion. The essence of their da'wah was based on this. Worshipping Allah alone, not associating partners with Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. The ibadah being only for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Walidalik, the great scholar, Hafidh al-Hakami rahimahullah, in his kitab Sulam al-Wusul, ila ilm al-Usul, he mentions these two conditions. He says, شَرْطُ قَبُولِ السَّعِي أَنْ يَجْتَمِعَ شَرْطُ قَبُولِ السَّعِي أَنْ يَجْتَمِعَ فِيهِ إِصَابَةٌ وَإِخْلَاصٌ مَعَ لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَرْشِ لَا سِوَاهُ مُوَافِقًا شَرْعِ الَّذِي اقْتَضَاهُ وَكُلُّ مَا خَالَفَ لِلْوَحْيَيْنِ فَإِنَّهُ رَدٌّ بِغَيْرِ مَيْنِ. حافظ الحكمي, he says, شَرْطُ قَبُولِ السَّعِي, the condition, the prerequisite for any action being accepted is what? شَرْطُ قَبُولِ السَّعِي أَنْ يَجْتَمِعَ. Two things have to be combined in it. What are they? He's going to mention it to you. شَرْطُ قَبُولِ السَّعِي أَنْ يَجْتَمِعَ فِيهِ إِصَابَةٌ وَإِخْلَاصٌ مَعَ. إِصَابَة means in accordance to the sunnah. Like Fudayl Mi'yadin said, أَصْوَبُ. إِصَابَة means you do it in accordance to how the Prophet did it. وَإِخْلَاصٌ مَعَ, and you do it with sincerity. وَإِخْلَاصٌ مَعَ لِلَّهِ, you only do it for Allah. There's no one else in your mind. Which ilah? لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَرْشِ لَا سِوَاهُ, the Lord of the throne. Allahu Azza wa Jalla, you only do for him. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. Lillahi Rabbil Arshi la siwahu. Muwafiqan shar'i alladhi irtadahu. And you do it in accordance to the religion and the legislation that he's pleased with. My beloved brothers and sisters, Allah is from the unseen. We haven't seen him, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And there is no one who saw Allah Azza wa Jalla that can tell us how he looks like. When it comes to knowing someone, there are ways to know a person or how they look. And scholars, they say it's three ways. Either he tells you how he looks. That's one. And Allah hasn't told us how he looks, subhanahu wa ta'ala. He told us his characteristics and attributes. But how are those characteristics and attributes? He hasn't told us. That's one. The second thing is, someone saw him and he's telling us about it. And no one has seen Allah Azza wa Jalla. And the third one is, Allah is similar to something, and he looks like something, we can compare it from that thing. And there isn't. There isn't. So because of those three, we do not know anything about Allah except that which the Prophet told us about him. What Allah loves, what Allah is pleased with, what he wants, what he doesn't want. We don't know that. It's from the ghaybiyat, it's from the unseen. So you can't know whether this act Allah is happy with it or not, except through the Prophet ﷺ. Ibadah is a what? It's an act Allah loves and is pleased, right? اسم جامع لكل ما يحبه الله ويرضاه من الأقوال والأعمال الظاهرة والباطنة. It is every speech and action, external and internal, that Allah loves and is pleased with. How do you know this act Allah loves it? And how do you know Allah is pleased with it? You could only know it through who? The Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام. وكل ما خالف للوحيين فإنه رد بغير مين. Anything that opposes the Quran and the Sunnah is rejected. Don't ever think to yourself that it's going to be accepted from you. So we just took, my beloved brothers and sisters, there are two foundations for any act to be accepted. A recap. The first is ألا يعبد الله أما ألا يعبد إلا الله وحده. The first one is only Allah is worshipped, subhanahu wa ta'ala. No one else. This act is only done for Allah, subhanahu wa ta'ala. No one else. Only Allah. The second is what? أَلَّا يُعْبَدَ اللَّهُ إِلَّا بِمَا شَرَعَ. That Allah is not worshipped except in the way He legislated, the way He sanctioned, the way He ordained, subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's the only way we worship Allah, subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَلِذَلِكَ Allah says in the ayah, وَعْبُدُوا اللَّهَ وَلَا تُشْرِكُوا بِهِ شَيْئًا. Worship Allah, come with ibadah, وَلَا تُشْرِكُوا بِهِ شَيْئًا. And do not do shirk with Him. Do not associate partners with Him in the ibadah. Ponder here with me, my beloved brothers and sisters. The ayah says, وَعْبُدُ اللَّهَ worship Allah. وَلَا تُشْرِكُوا بِهِ and do not, a prohibition here, we've been prohibited. Well, because the la here is a la unnahiyya. It's the la of prohibition. We're being told, وَلَا do not. So it's a prohibition. What are we being prohibited from? وَلَا تُشْرِكُوا بِهِ شَيْئًا. Do not associate partners with him. The word shay'an here is an indefinite. And how do we know it's an indefinite? We know it because there's a tanween in there, and that tanween is known as tanween al-tankir. It's the tanween of indefinite. Now here a principle comes out. This principle that comes out here is what? If a indefinite is in the context of a prohibition. So the prohibition was before that, which is what? Wala, la. It's a prohibition. And the word shay'an is an indefinite. It shows generalization. In other words, there is no one, anything that you can associate partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in ibadah. No one. لا ملك مقرب ولا نبي مرسل. Whether it's a close angel to Allah or whether it's a messenger and a prophet that was sent by Allah, it doesn't matter. وَعْبُدُ اللَّهَ worship Allah. وَلَا تُشْرِكُوا بِهِ شَيْئًا. شَيْئًا here is a what? It's a nakira. Nakira what? فِي سِيَاقِ النَّهِي. It's an indefinite. In the context of a prohibition. فَتَعُمْ. It shows generalization. وَلِذَلِكَ the qa'ida is إِذَا وَقَعَتِ النَّكِرَ. Remember this principle. And students of knowledge, take your pens out and write this point. إِذَا وَقَعَتِ النَّكِرَ. If an indefinite falls في سياق النهي أو النفي أو الشرط تفيد العموم. If an indefinite falls, an indefinite falls in the context of three things I mentioned, in the context of a prohibition or a negation or a condition, تفيد العموم, it benefits your generalization. And a nakira is a what? It's a nakira is the opposite of a ma'rifa. We have a ma'rifa and we have a nakira. A ma'rifa is generally the words that have al in there. Masjid is indefinite. Al masjid is now definite. We know the masjid. The masjid. That's why the poet he mentioned Ibn Malik in his Alfiya, nakira qabilu al mu'athira aw waqi'u al mawqi'a ma qad dhukira. The word nakira means indefinite. Like we say, for example, in the English language, the apple is a definite. We know the apple. And if you say an apple, it becomes a what? It becomes an indefinite. So the word nakira is an indefinite. So here what we took from this benefit is that you are not allowed to associate partners with Allah, no one. Generalization. And this generalization, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala actually mentioned in a particular verse. He emphasized on that point. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, he says, ma kana li basharin. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, he says, ma kana li basharin an yu'tiyahu Allahu al-kitaba wal-hukma wal-nubuwa thumma yaqula lin-nasi kunu ibadan li min dunillah ولكن كونوا ربانيين بما كنتم تعلمون الكتاب وبما كنتم تدرسون ولا يأمركم أن تتخذوا الملائكة والنبيين أربابا أيأمركم بالكفر بعد إذ أنتم مسلمون. Allah says in this verse, ما كان لبشر, there is, it cannot happen, it is not for a human, لبشر أن يكلمه الله. Allah spoke to him, i.e. a prophet. The ayah is talking about a prophet. There is not a person who Allah will choose him to become a prophet and give him prophecy, or make him a messenger, or make him a prophet. Allah gives him wisdom. He gives him the book, and then he comes to the people and he says, "Worship me." ما كان لبشر أن يؤتيه الله الكتاب والحكم والنبوة ثم, and then he comes to the people, ثم يقول للناس كونوا عبادا لي من دون الله. Worship me besides Allah. No prophet will ever do that. Never do that. Prophets don't do that. Messengers don't do that. They don't command you. They will never command you to worship them. وَلَا يَأْمُرَكُمْ أَن تَتَّخِذُوا الْمَلَائِكَةَ وَالنَّبِيِّينَ أَرْبَابًا. And they won't even command you to worship the angels. Is there anyone better than the prophets and the angels? They won't tell you to worship neither of those two. So here what we learn, my beloved brothers and sisters, is that worshipping Allah alone, subhanahu wa ta'ala, is the first foundation and the first principle that we all have to agree on. And the way that this ibadah has to be done is in accordance to the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when we testify and we say, wa ashhadu, I testify, wa ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah, when you say, I testify that Muhammad is the messenger of Allah, you are saying, tasdiqu fi ma akhbar, wa ta'atuhu fi ma amar, wa ijtinabu ma naha anhu wa zajar, wa an la yu'bad Allahu illa bima shara. The minute you say, ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah, I bear witness that Muhammad is a messenger of Allah, you're agreeing to the following things. تَصْدِيقُ فِي مَا أَخْبَرَ. You are believing in him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in everything he told you. وَطَاعَتُ فِي مَا أَمَرَ. And everything he commanded you, you obey him in it. This is the point I want from it. عِبَادَةً, the Prophet will tell you how to do it. So you follow and you obey him in that عِبَادَةً. وَطَاعَتُ فِي مَا أَمَرَ. Because Allah says in the ayah, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَا مِن رَسُولٍ إِلَّا لِيُطَاعَ بِإِذْنِ اللَّهِ. We have not sent a messenger except that he needs to be obeyed. The Prophet and the messengers, they were sent to be obeyed. وَطَاعَتُ فِي مَا أَمَرْ وَاجْتِنَابُ مَا نَهَا عَنْهُ وَزَجَرْ. And you have to stay away from that which he stayed away from, عليه الصلاة والسلام. And he told us to stay away from. The things that he told us to stay away from, we have to stay away from it. وَاجْتِنَابُ مَا نَهَا عَنْهُ وَزَجَرْ وَأَلَّا يُعْبَدَ اللَّهُ. And we do not worship Allah, وَأَلَّا يُعْبَدَ اللَّهُ إِلَّا بِمَا شَرَعْ. We worship Allah in the way that he legislated, subhanahu wa ta'ala. My beloved brothers and sisters, the last point I want to conclude by saying is that we can't come with ibadah based on it feels right, it logically makes sense to me, oh, this is the right, this is the best thing, I should do this. No, ibadah doesn't come about like that. The religion is based upon submission and following the way of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. ولذلك the poet he said, فَالدِّينُ إِنَّمَا أَتَى بِالنَّقْلِ لَيْسَ بِالْأَوْهَامِ وَحَدْسِ الْعَقْلِ. فَالدِّينُ, the religion, comes through transmission, narrations. The Prophet did this. The Prophet sanctioned this. He said this, alayhi salatu wasalam. You need evidence for what you're doing. لَيْسَ بِالْأَوْهَامِ. It's not based on wahm, speculations and thoughts that came to your mind and you feel, oh, this is the best thing I've ever done. I spiritually feel uplifted. That's not an evidence for ibadah to be accepted. ولذلك many of the people, Abd al-Rahman Yahya al-Mu'allimi mentions, in his kitab, Risala, in which he wrote on the concept of ibadah, which I encourage any one of you to read that book. He mentions in that book of his that many people have fallen into innovation and went against the ibadah that was sanctioned by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and made their own ibadah up, all based upon what? Tajriba. Oh, I tried this and it felt good. Oh, I felt like this was the best thing. When I did it, my heart, I was so energized. Ibadat are not based on that, my beloved brothers and sisters. Especially now that we are going through a hard time. We are now going through the COVID-19, a plague or a pandemic. This is something Allah wants us to run back to. Allah says, وَلَقَدْ أَخَذْنَاهُمْ بِالْعَذَابِ فَمَا اسْتَكَانُوا لِرَبِّهِمْ وَمَا يَتَضَرَّعُونَ. This is, we've been put through this, so we humble ourselves and run back to Allah. It's not this time that we innovate things. It's at this moment that we run back and we do ibadat in accordance to the way of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. Now I'm going to move on to, inshallah ta'ala, the second, bi'idhnillahi al-kareem, the second introduction for this series, bi'idhnillahi al-kareem.
Assalamu alaikum. If you're enjoying these videos and you'd like to keep up to date with all of the courses we're going to be running, make sure you head over to amauathome.com.